The plan to literally shock the people of the world into submission clearly goes beyond the obvious disasters and political upheavals that Klein points out in her book. The Marc Dutroux affair was used to reorganize the Belgian justice system, including a push for the creation of a cult watchdog group like Miviludes. Henry Lee Lucas was used both to horrify the public and as a scapegoat to pin a variety of mysterious murders on. The pedophile prostitution ring run by Lawrence King, using children from Boys Town, was used not only to serve the twisted needs of political and corporate elites, but to blackmail politicians into supporting policies and laws that benefited these same elites. These are only a few examples of the unimaginable sickness that appears to pervade all governments on the planet. These cases are not merely incidents of bad people achieving positions of power. They are the norm. The sickness is systemic. The abuse seems to bear all of the hallmarks of a vast counterintelligence program for gaining more power over the minds and lives of the public. Given the virtually identical pattern of abuse and protection in both the US and in Europe, organizations like Miviludes appear increasingly like protectors of the abusers, not the public. Aside from the connections to all of this that we have already explored, there is another key connection between Scientology and these cults of abuse. Satanism. The essence of so-called black magic is gaining power over other people. This is also what is behind all mind control programs, ritual child abuse, and Scientology. The Nazis' interest in magic and the occult is also well documented, and directly related to their search for ways of gaining the greatest possible control over the populace and gaining power. Immediately after World War II, many of these same Nazi researchers interested in the use of the occult to gain control and power were secretly brought to the US to continue their research via Operation Paperclip. Operation Paperclip was officially approved in August of 1945. Perhaps coincidentally, the genesis of Dianetics seems to trace back to that same year. The official Scientology biography of Hubbard states that in 1945, he was left partially blind with injured optic nerves and lame from hip and back injuries, and that Mr. Hubbard was hospitalized at Oak Knoll Naval Hospital in Oakland, California. Allegedly, he then spent the next years healing himself by applying the principles that would become the foundation for his 1950 book, Dianetics, the book that gave rise to the Church of Scientology. However, in an earlier interview quoted on the Scientology site RonThePoet.com, Hubbard gives a very different account of that time, saying, "I spent the last year of my naval career at a naval hospital, not very ill, but I had a couple of holes in me. They wouldn't heal, so they just kept me." What neither the official biography nor this earlier interview mentions is the fact that Hubbard, after leaving the hospital, moved in with self-taught chemist, rocket scientist, and co-founder of JPL, the Jet Propulsion Laboratory in Pasadena, California, Jack Parsons. Parsons was not only a brilliant rocket scientist, he was a self-proclaimed Satanist, black magician, and avid follower of Aleister Crowley, the British Satanist who dubbed himself the Beast 666. Parsons had dubbed himself the Antichrist. In 1945, Hubbard moved in with Parsons and they became very close friends. Together, in 1946, they performed a magical ritual called the Babylon Working, intended to give a physical incarnation to the so-called Whore of Babylon, or Mother of Abominations. The Babylon Working was a sex magic ritual in which L. Ron Hubbard played the part of high priest as Parsons had sex with a young girl. Curiously, Hubbard was allegedly a neophyte in Satanism and magic when Parsons gave him the role of high priest in this ceremony. Parsons wrote to Crowley that, "Although Hubbard has no formal training in magic, he has an extraordinary amount of experience and understanding in the field." Clearly, there is far more to L. Ron Hubbard's history than is covered in his official biography. Following the completion of the Babylon Working by Parsons and Hubbard, Parsons again wrote to Crowley, exclaiming, "Babylon is incarnate upon the earth today, awaiting the proper hour of her manifestation. And in that day, my work will be accomplished, and I shall be blown away upon the breath of the Father, even as it is prophesied." In yet another strange coincidence, Parsons was literally blown away 6 years later by an explosion in his home laboratory. Immediately following Hubbard's announcement of the foundation of Scientology, foul play has been suspected, but one can't help but wonder if Parsons blew himself away to fulfill the prophecy once he saw the Mother of Abominations incarnate in the world as Hubbard's new Scientology movement. All of this tends to lend credence to the claim of Hubbard's son, Rhonda Wolf, that Scientology is actually black magic.
Really, the basis of Scientology, which is rather hidden and covered over, is the occult, deep involvement with satanic powers. He felt that he was deeply involved with British black magician called Aleister Crowley. And through putting himself in deep hypnotic trances and the use of drugs on himself, he wanted to become the most powerful being in the world.
This is further supported by the obvious relationship of Scientology symbols to occult symbols. The main Scientology symbol appears to be a variation on the central symbol of the Brotherhood of Luxor. And the Scientology cross bears more than a passing resemblance to the cross that adorns the back of Aleister Crowley's tarot cards. But perhaps the strongest evidence that Hubbard's Scientology is an attempt to apply principles of black magic and satanic worship to mass manipulation of the public comes from his own lips.
He could simply say, I have action. A magician, the magic cults of the 8th, 9th, 10th, 11th, 12th centuries in the Middle East were fascinating. The only modern work that has anything to do with them is Trifle Wild in Spots, but it's fascinating work in itself, and that's work written by Aleister Crowley, the late Aleister Crowley, my very good friend.
Nazi mind control scientists brought to the U.S. via Operation Paperclip, the introduction of drugs into social movements and onto the streets, the infiltration and subversion of the human potential and women's liberation movements by the CIA, the destruction of the civil rights movement, the rise of satanic worship taking the forms of child abuse cults, pedophilia, and the modified black magic of Scientology, and the protection of and distraction away from all of these by courts and government groups like Miviludes. Examining this evidence, the following picture emerges. Seeing the possibility of a widespread change in values beginning with the growing civil rights movement, a massive counterintelligence program was launched. The purpose of this program would be the infiltration, subversion, and misdirection of all groups and movements that might contribute to this change in values. Once the civil rights movement had been stopped and all other movements had been subverted, the specter of cults and, more recently, terrorists, along with institutionally sponsored abuse, was used to coerce the public into accepting greater levels of governmental control of their lives. And organizations like Miviludes were then created to protect those committing institutional abuse and battle against those attempting to expose or heal the effects of this abuse, all under the guise of protecting the public. We encourage you to examine this evidence for yourself. And if you reach conclusions similar to ours, we also ask you to think. Do you want to live in a world ruled by abusive and psychopathic monsters?